Even if this is close to fall break after uploading all my Christmas videos of this month, don't really expect me to do something, at least something special during the final week of this year. Because let's be real, I'm still having plans on reviewing Steven Universe in January, and I'm planning to wrap this entire anthology up in February. And considering I'm reviewing 6 episodes instead of 5, which my original plans was 5, mostly because one of the episodes wasn't worth reviewing on when it comes to my perspective, it really shows that rewatching these episodes are a lot more important than getting straight into reviewing these episodes. So the first episode I'm going to be looking at is Steven's birthday. It's Steven's 14th birthday, and the shocking thing is, Connie realizes this to think that Steven was like 10 or 11, but apparently he's 2 years older than her. For me personally, after watching Steven Universe Future and the movie, it really made me understand the struggle that Steven is doing in this episode. If I did watch this episode back in 2015 or 16, I'm pretty sure that my perspective will probably be mostly towards the comedy and mostly of how Steven is learning how to handle his abilities as a gem. But then again, this is the second season. And considering that this is still a Connverse episode, it really sums up of what Steven needs to deal with in the future involving his relationship with Connie. But for what we have in store in seasons 5 and onward, believe me, there's gonna be a lot to discuss, but we'll get to that in February. So, Steven wants to impress Connie because the fact that he won't be able to grow up because he's still part gem. And with the gems not having the ability to age, it's gonna be a lot more complicated once Connie becomes president and Steven thinks that he will be best boy or first boy. And when he saw Amethyst using her powers to have long legs and long arms, he gets an idea which, considering that he is half human, isn't a good idea. Upon the birthday surprise from Steven's family, he completely grows his arms and legs, making them just like Amethyst, but not completely stretchy. And considering that this is something that he has to deal with for the rest of the day, and this leads to a consequence that has a limited recovery, as in taking about less than 12 hours or so, I really think that Steven really didn't know what to do involving growing up, unlike other humans do in Beach City. Let me just say that Connie in this episode, despite the height animation errors, let me just say this right now, I have an issue with the animation in the later seasons involving the character's height, but in all honesty, this show is trying to be mostly cheaply, but it's not really working when it comes to the main episodes compared to the shorts. Anyway, Connie's development in this episode being a lot more straightforward compared to her previous appearances, since that she is getting impressed by Steven's height and the fact that she is aware of what's going to happen in the future, I really have a feeling that if Steven never got older in the movie and in future, I'm pretty sure it will probably make this relationship a lot more odd to see Steven as a little child, even if he is 14, while the other characters have grown older and older than him, but more specifically, Connie herself. And considering he's gonna be in this position while being by Connie's side for the rest of his life, believe me, it'll be difficult to have this adjustment be active in this position. If you really believe me of how Steven wants to grow up at the same time he can't because he's part gem, believe me, I'm pretty sure that his trauma that's gonna be explored in the later seasons really sums up everything of his character development. Not just with his relationship with Connie, but also his character himself. But fortunately, that didn't last long as he turns into a baby due to him staying in that position for way too long. I would consider this cute, but considering that it was really painful for Steven to try to be more taller than Connie, I really think that I can easily pick a different alternative by staying in the way of who I am. Granted, the lesson of this episode is that it doesn't matter if you're taller or shorter than Connie. Connie will still come with Steven doing his adventures regardless. Not much compared to the other episodes of having Steven in the Crystal Gems, but at the same time, knowing of what it has in store for the later seasons of having Connie and Steven's relationship, and I do mention seasons 5, I'm going to try to find some other ways for Connie's justifications of her choices in those seasons. But at the same time, just by watching these two characters, especially from this episode, which is the final episode of season 2 involving their relationship, I can say that it's a good wrap-up. Seasons 1 and 2 really represents the beginning arc of Steven and Connie. Granted, you can say that it somewhat ends in the beginning of the second season involving them making an agreement after Steven tried to avoid her, but the thing is, I'm pretty sure that Connie becoming a sword fighter, along with her parents somewhat making agreements with her, I'm pretty sure that this episode is basically the real wrap-up involving the first half of Steven and Connie's relationship. And considering that we're halfway wrapping up this anthology, it really sums up onto why I'm reviewing 6 episodes, and probably more in the following part, depending on what happens. So I give Steven's birthday a 7.5 out of 10, and as for the following episode, Beach City Drift, we finally get back to a character that I've last discussed since the beginning of this year, and that character is Kevin. And considering that I've mentioned before that he only appears in the Steven and Connie episodes, his presence in this episode is, if not, a lot more difficult to adjust compared to his previous appearance. Since that we all know that he misunderstood Stefani as Steven and Connie, not to mention that he was hitting on her without her being fully okay with it, he still decides to hit on Stefani even though that he's aware that it's a kid and a girl in an adult's body, or just a gem fusion, but you all know what Stefani is. Let me talk about the rivalry between Steven and Kevin, even though that Kevin doesn't have anything against Steven, but Steven does have something against Kevin. Knowing that Steven is in complete hatred with characters like Kevin, but not the Diamonds, let me just say this right now, I'm pretty sure that he really hates fancy cars or anything, and mostly fancy, hip people who completely think that they're better than everyone else. Usually, I would empathize Steven's choices of what he likes and what he doesn't like, but considering that this leads to a bit of contradictory with his encounters with other characters as the series goes on, I really feel like that he really doesn't even know what Kevin is other than him just hanging on Stefani, which was his first encounter with him. Greg said that Kevin isn't really worth it, especially for someone who instantly hits on so many girls. Let me just say this right now, every other person who is Kevin will always hit on a girl that he sees in first sight, mostly love at first sight, but in his own version of love at first sight. And knowing that Connie does hate Kevin, but at the same time not the same way as Steven does, she always keeps her emotions to herself. Usually this type of development made me understand Connie a lot more compared to how she acts towards later of the series, but knowing that she is willing to help Steven becoming Stefani while also face Kevin in a car race, I really don't know what to think involving Connie's development in this episode. I can only assume that even if Stefani is still a different character, it doesn't change the fact that Steven and Connie's minds are still part of Stefani regardless. And Steven's, which is the other half of Stefani, thinks that Kevin is stealing Connie from her, even though that Connie is the other side of Stefani. I really think that it really feels a lot more awkward to think that Steven is dealing with Kevin stealing Connie, even though that it doesn't make a difference because he is part of Stefani. I don't know, maybe it's supposed to be a love triangle, but at the same time it really isn't, because that really isn't the case whatsoever involving Kevin's development. Yes, I am fully aware that Kevin is hitting on Stefani, which does make sense for a love triangle, but the thing is, he isn't a simp. Because even if he's trying, he knows he isn't a simp whatsoever. Because unlike Molokai, Finn, and Panda from Adventure Time, We Bear Bells, and Regular Show, Kevin is way ahead of the lead. And considering he's doing all this just to mess with Stefani while having her being unfocused with the waist itself, let me just say this right now, he's probably doing a lot just so that Stefani would cry so that he can hang out with her. Granted, that's not really what he's trying to do, but that's what I'm thinking, judging for how he's being portrayed in this episode. And knowing that he somewhat understands that Stefani is a fusion of two children, it's gonna be a lot more difficult to find any enjoyment from this character, except that he is done portrayally good as a somewhat antagonist. He may not be a villain, but he is still a Beach City antagonist. And if you ask me, that really sums up Stefani's development in this, is because even when Steven and Connie are fused together, they're still having a difficult time working together and adjusting the fusion. And believe it or not, this is the second episode I'm reviewing involving Stefani. In the second part, I did not discuss anything involving Stefani because there was no fusion whatsoever. So I have to be real, with this being the second Stefani episode despite having fusions of her in the past, I really feel like that this episode's biggest highlight is Stefani herself. Especially since two children are actually driving a vehicle, even though they do not have a driver's license. And the more I think about this, the more I can easily feel sympathy towards Steven, but also Connie, in this race that they got themselves in. And when they learn that they do not have to play Kevin's game whatsoever by getting trolled at, I have to admit, the ending of this episode really feels satisfying, but also interesting, involving Stefani's development. And the fact that Kevin really feels like he got rejected by a girl that he has a crush on, despite the fact that he is never going to get the girl, really sums up of how he's gonna be in Kevin's party. And even though that episode has a lot to discuss, me discussing Kevin in that episode, since that his name is in the title of the episode, I'm pretty sure that there was really no point to have him in any other episode other than just being an obstacle for not only for Steven and Connie, but also Stefani. So even if this episode isn't as better than the last episode, I feel like that this episode does a lot more involving Stefani, and the fact that it does follow the development and the relationship of Steven and Connie. Then again, I'm reviewing nearly all the episodes involving the Connverse episode, so expect the unexpected. I give this episode a 7 out of 10. Gem Hunt. Well, even if I did not review the somewhat Christmas episode involving Steven Universe, since I skipped that last year and I'm going to be doing the same thing this year, this is somewhat of a Christmas episode, even though that there's no Christmas related, but the snow, that's at least something. Even if I am done with my Christmas videos, I still have something winter related, since that we're finally in the winter season. Anyway, Connie is going on her very first mission with Paul and Steven, and it's in a winter wasteland. Believe me, the fact that we get an episode involving Connie going on an actual adventure after the rules are not restricted involving her family, I really feel like that they could have done a lot more in later episodes involving this ideal. But let me just say this right now, considering that the production involving Steven Universe is a lot more mixed compared to other productions of TV shows, I really feel like that this episode really feels like the only episode where Connie is on an adventure, but at the same time, it isn't supposed to be the only adventure she went on, because she did tag along with Steven in Season 5. It's mostly because of how the show is focusing on other characters, so I can easily understand that. But knowing that after watching these episodes and knowing that Connie is actually, well, Connie in this episode and being a lot more respective with Steven, it just makes me questions on what the later seasons would have been like if we actually see actual development involving her struggle as an explorer like Steven is in almost every other venture that he went on with the Crystal Gems. Getting back on track, this episode is mostly about Steven, Connie, and Paul trying to find more corrupted gems in the Winter Wasteland, and they decide to split up, leaving Paul by herself while Steven and Connie work together to find more corrupted gems. If you binge watch all the episodes up to this episode, we all know that Steven cannot fix corrupted gems completely, and considering that he needs to figure out some other way to help fully corrupted gems by not healing them, it really shows that the corrupted gems do have more abilities that can easily turn them back to normal, or just trying to have more mean of their existence. Knowing that of how much that this show portrays the crystal gems or the corrupted gems a lot more different from each other, especially the episode where Garnet is afraid of force fusion, I'm pretty sure that even with Connie on this mission, there won't be any difference. I mean, Steven has the ability to protect Connie with his bubble powers, and considering that they gave Paul a walkie-talkie so that they can call her in case of need of help, it really shows that if Amethyst and Garnet are in this episode, they will probably be in Paul's position regardless. And the biggest reason onto why they split up is because there are two corrupted gems wandering in the wasteland. If you really think that if they have the other crystal gems to help out, then this episode wouldn't be an episode. It would be just like a crystal gems adventure with Steven. So I really feel like that they're trying to figure out some other ways, or the fact that the other gems are in different locations to find more corrupted gems. But then again, that's mostly the job at being crystal gems. But when it comes to this episode, it really shows that Paula still needs help, even though that she really doesn't need the help from Steven and Connie. All that she wants is to have a call from either Connie or Steven about one of the corrupted gems. But all this leads to is them encountering Jasper herself, and I'm going to discuss her character in the following episode. But let me just say this right now, the fact that the following episode is actually part of the Connverse episodes, which I'm actually surprised. I really feel like rewatching these episodes really sums up of how important they are compared to what happens afterwards. So, all in all, I really feel like that they actually knew what they were doing involving Jasper's appearance in this episode and the following episode. Since that the corrupted gems were running away from her, and the corrupted gems were attacking Steven and Connie because they think that they're about to attack them by the noise that they're causing. I can guarantee you that if it wasn't for Jasper's small cameo appearance towards the end of this episode, then this episode will probably be a lot more worthless, while making the following episode mostly about Amethyst and Jasper. Granted, Steven and Connie also in that episode, but knowing of how much that I've rewatched that episode in preparation for reviewing it for this video, I really feel like that this show's all your seasons, especially this, has really come a long way. So once we get into the following episode, I give this episode a 7.25 out of 10. The following episode, Crack the Whip. Granted, whether you say of this still being an Amethyst episode that involves her development in the following episode while she faces Steven, it still really feels like another Connverse episode when it comes to Steven and Connie working together and becoming the fusion. Just to point this out, in the last episode, Gem Hunt, they did not fuse together. And this is the second to last episode I'm going to be reviewing involving Savani in this video, at least. Paul and Garnet are doing more gem hunting involving more corrupted gems. And since that Paul promised that Connie can do sword training with her, apparently she has to scrap that so that she can focus on her mission with Garnet. So, while they're gone, Amethyst is taking care of Steven and Connie, and mostly Lion. So, for the first half of this episode, Amethyst is training Steven and Connie, but mostly just her goofing off while the other characters have fun at Beach City. Nothing else other than the second half being mostly a contributor towards the episode's title. But considering that this is still an Amethyst episode at the end of the day, I should probably discuss Amethyst because, let's be real, I really feel like that after doing three videos involving Steven and Connie while reviewing the most episodes involving Steven and Connie, I'm probably never going to talk about the other character, so I should probably discuss Amethyst's development in this episode. I'm pretty sure that her development in the later seasons, especially this, is a lot more lackluster compared to how she was portrayed when other characters got more development than her. I understand it's difficult to have every other character being fully developed, but to be honest, Amethyst isn't really much of a big loss. Granted, I do like the episode settling around her in the first season and maybe the second, but when it comes to her appearances afterwards, she is still a comic relief, even though that she is still a crystal gem that Paul and Garnet found. Now, I need to make one thing clear. I can understand that Amethyst's character can't be a lot more different when she is mostly a gem that Paul and Garnet kept over the last several years before Rose turned to Steven, but I really feel like that the way that she gets less development than the other gems, I really feel like that she probably had the missed opportunities compared to other gems that didn't get any development. And believe me, Lapras, despite the fact that she had less development as a gem of her own, probably had a lot more established development than Amethyst. Granted, it is mostly depressing to see that Amethyst is in a position where she's mostly different from every other gem. But at the same time, it really feels like the animators are just focusing on her facial expressions and the humor that she provides. Usually, I can understand what people would feel involving her character, especially from other perspectives, from other people, but just by watching this episode of the fact that she wasn't able to take down Jasper because she got poofed by Jasper, which leads to Savani and Lion taking down Jasper, it somewhat makes the following episode mostly a closure of Amethyst's arc. Granted, I can understand that it really isn't the case because I did not watch other episodes for a second time, but at the same time, I do not binge watch the entire series a second time, only once. So, just to get this out of the way, I do not plan on reviewing the following episode, Steven vs. Amethyst, next month or anytime soon, because even though that it does involve Amethyst's arc involving a crystal gem, but at the same time, there really isn't much towards her character as the series goes forward. But as for Jasper in this episode, since that she is similar to Amethyst but also an antagonist, I really feel like that they did a great job to making Jasper probably a lot more intimidating even after her fusion with Lapras is completely over. It is really impressive to think that Amethyst doesn't stand a chance against Jasper, especially in the form that she's in. Believe it or not, I really feel like that Jasper really does make an interesting threat when the diamonds are mostly out of the picture, while we completely see Jasper doing most of the work. It really astounds me of how much that they really put so much effort into Jasper's character in seasons like these. When it comes to future seasons, well, she remains the same, except that she is still somewhat of an anti-friend or an anti-enemy or a frenemy with Steven, especially in the final episode. It really makes Jasper one of the characters to not change completely, but at the same time, not wreaking havoc on any obstacle that comes her way. And the fight scene between Stefani and Jasper is probably the most interesting compared to seeing her facing off with Amethyst, because judging of how much that she poofed Amethyst and the fact that Steven and Connie needs to fuse together in order to take down Jasper, and the fact that they somewhat defeated her, it actually makes this more of an accomplishment that Steven and Connie can be able to work together. But let me just tell you, this is also further proof that even with Stefani, they can't be able to take down any obstacle involving corrupted gems or anything on Homeworld. And let me just say this right now, it's gonna be a lot more difficult to believe that Connie ends up leaving Steven for nearly a month or two or 2 weeks just because she wasn't able to be with him on Homeworld. I do have my own predictions of what I feel could have been much more better when it comes to better writing decisions, but I'm gonna be saving that for the following video. I may have gone too long by discussing this episode mostly involving Amethyst and Jasper, but to give this episode credit for being somewhat of a Converse episode, I really feel like that this relationship between Steven and Connie really sums up of what they do in the following episode, Mindful Education. But before we get to that, I need to discuss one more thing. If it wasn't for Stefani taking down Jasper while taking Amethyst's gem before she gets taken away, I'm pretty sure that this episode will be mostly involving Amethyst, because if this episode is mostly about Stefani being much more powerful when it comes to her training, and the fact that Steven and Connie actually are working together in order to save Amethyst from getting taken away, I really feel like that this episode does a really good job by having the other characters have somewhat of a focus, even though in the majority of this episode, they're mostly getting trained by Amethyst. In part one of this anthology, I did mention I was going to be skipping on a few episodes because they didn't really feel important involving Steven's relationship with Connie, but the more I watch them and the more I understand their relationship and development, it really sums up that almost all the episodes are actually important. Granted, the Garnet and Jamie and the Jamie-centered episode while Steven and Connie are reading Jamie's book aren't really that important involving this relationship, but after rewatching this episode, I can guarantee you that part 4 is going to be a lot more complex with the amount of episodes I need to put my focus on involving Connie's presence in those episodes. But let me tell you, this is still my first ever anthology minus the Shaolin Showdown trilogies. Since I'm focusing on multiple episodes in one video and I need to save this project for a later time in multiple parts, I will need to expect the unexpected, which I'm probably gonna experience once I do more of these videos in the future. I'm giving this episode a 7.5 out of 10. Now here's an episode that you've been looking forward for me to review once you clicked onto this video, Mindful Education. This episode not only develops the relationship, but also Steven and Connie's character separately, since we all know that these characters never had any other friends except each other once we got into Bubble Buddies, which was the very first episode of Connie's appearance. Connie is having a difficult time focusing on her training when she made a huge mistake at school by attacking Jeff, who is one of the students in her school. And let me just say this right now, if you can easily tell that Connie is really the type of person who wouldn't do that to anyone and having problems with, then you do not understand how lonely she is. It's already established that Connie has always been alone before Stephen got into her life. And considering that she has developed a lot more as a person and more of a sore file, then believe me when I say this, is that you'll probably be in Connie's position if you was this lonely and you hung out with someone who can easily understand why you're feeling this way. And that person is Stephen himself. But even with that, Stephen is also dealing with trauma once we get into the final minutes of this episode. But I'm gonna get to that later. Garnet tells Stephen and Connie to fuse into Stefani so that she can talk to her. And this leads to her singing a song called "Here Comes a Thought." Believe it or not, every time I think of Garnet in this episode and the fact that she contributes the advice she gives to Stefani, all the while showcasing the relationship of Ruby and Sapphire, I really feel like that without Garnet in this episode wouldn't be this good. If anything, it will probably make most of Connie's problems a lot more complicated if she doesn't get any advice from any of the crystal gems. Especially the song being almost 3 minutes makes this entire sequence a lot more interesting, since that most of the songs in the show are really well done and really good to be placed in. And if you don't believe me, then go look at my review of Steven Universe the movie where I just review all the songs towards the end of that video, because even if I did say that they're mostly unnecessary, that doesn't mean that they're out of place. And considering that Steven Universe does a good job into making these songs in place in these episodes, then I don't think that Rebecca Sugar wouldn't been a good songwriter if she completely scraps the songs from the show. Granted, if I ever get the chance to review each song, it would take a long time, but at the same time, I really feel like that each song does something a lot more meaningful in Steven Universe. But getting back to the song and the scenes involving Connie's struggle, I'm pretty sure this is the closest way we're ever going to see a character involving Steven Universe that isn't Steven that we actually get to see some development outside of Steven's perspective, because we did see Connie completely attacking Jeff and the fact that it happened during her surroundings at school. But the thing is, since that we barely knew how she spends her time at school and the fact that this is the only episode where we get to see bits of her school, even if it's just mostly during this sequence, then we can actually see her development a lot more fleshed out completely. And believe me when I say this, the fact that the more I watch these episodes and the more I try to get an understanding of the criticisms of what people have expressed towards characters like Connie, mainly from this season, I really feel like that they really knew what was the biggest problem involving Steven Universe when everything is mostly catered to Steven when it comes to his perspective. Granted, in the beginning of the episode while Steven's just trying to mess with Connie that he's bald, even though that he isn't, Connie doesn't really care whatsoever because of what she did at school. If Steven was mostly pointless in this episode, then I can easily tell that this is definitely a Steven-only's perspective that really damages this episode. But since that we have a few minutes until the episode ends, we get to see the struggle involving him. Well, it's mostly centering around the other Ruby. Sorry, I forgot her actual name, with a gem as one of her eyes. His encounter with Bismuth, which I did reveal 3 months ago. And not to mention the whole Jasper situation that he's dealing with, and also his mother. If you really think that if none of this ever happened in this episode, then I'm pretty sure that Steven wouldn't be able to contribute much to this episode. And since I've watched all the episodes, including Future, along with other people's reviews on one of these episodes, and the fact that it centers around Steven's trauma, then I'm pretty sure that for an episode that aired in 2016, foreshadows Steven's huge breakdown or meltdown towards the end of Future, despite most of what people think towards that sequence, this really has aged a lot more better compared to what people would usually think. Granted, I can't tell that people can easily see this episode the same way compared to the later episodes that they've seen involving a single pair of walls and such. Though I'm pretty sure for a fact that despite the analysis, they really miss most of the details of what the other episodes had in store. Granted, I don't usually blame them, considering that it's their own perspective of what they feel towards episodes like these, but in all honesty, people just don't understand what children are like whenever they have development like these. Granted, the pacing of this episode is mostly problematic, considering that in the final minutes of this, we don't get somewhat of a good conclusion involving Steven and Connie dealing with Steven's trauma whatsoever. And even though that it's mostly about moving on and not fixing everything and completely hurting everyone, I really feel like that Steven is really the type of character that just doesn't understand the meaning of moving on, but also moving forward, which is something that he quite somewhat forgot in Future. But let me tell you, once we get into the Future episodes in the following video in February, it's kind of obvious that the ambition involving characters like Steven, they always have an other side of the personality. And considering that most characters are two-faced at most, I really feel like that every other person in any other cartoon will always have the other side. Granted, I've discuss the trauma involving Steven since that there's still more in Future, but the thing is, it's really not that much of an important deal whenever I completely see Steven in this state and the fact that moving forward is going to be a little bit more complicated. Yes, I did see so many videos involving this issue involving Steven, but the thing is, if you really see of how he's portrayed in all your seasons and the fact that people just pretty much didn't experience the trauma that Steven dealt with because, well, wars, even if they did exist in the past, but in wars from outer space, it never happens in the real world. But if it did, including all the stuff that he went through before and after this episode, Steven isn't SpongeBob. And since I've mentioned SpongeBob in this type of topic, well, he isn't really that intelligent, and he's mostly over the top when it comes to his personality. Steven has some of the similar traits involving SpongeBob, where he's mostly happy, but also doing what a kid usually do. But the thing is, this isn't the Bikini Bottom or anything involving underwater. And the fact that people are mostly against this whole Steven's trauma thing, despite the fact that they have good reasonings, you will probably not understand what it feels to have a character be in this position if you feel sympathy towards that, if you've ever been put in that situation. Granted, when you look at it without any of that issues, I can understand, but at the same time, if you knew how dangerous it is, then I'm pretty sure that the execution, despite being really flip-flop when it comes to screenwriters, then I can't say that this entire show is terrible because of the final seasons and the Kramps just flip-flopping the scripts. Because let me tell you, I can understand that this show fell from grace, but at the same time, that doesn't mean that I can consider it as a mediocre show. Besides, thinking about that would probably be a lot more redundant for the amount of shows that completely drop in quality with the final seasons. So just seeing the ambition in the show, I can easily give it an A for effort, even though that it could have been a lot more better if they actually had a constructive narrative. But then again, it's difficult to have a constructive narrative, whether it's a movie or a TV show. Granted, it needs to be almost 50% constructive when it comes to a perfect perspective of what people want to see from a character, but other times, it's mostly hard to keep track of everything of what people have been waiting for since the delays of Steven Universe. Granted, I'm not one of those people who had to wait this long for a new episode to come out only to learn that it's a Beach City episode, but unfortunately, even by watching all the episodes, it still proves that this show has less constructive narrative when it comes to the characters and how the arcs needs to be completed. So, despite what people think about this episode being good or bad, I still think that this is the best episode I've seen in this video. And in all honesty, I really feel like that giving this episode an 8.5 out of 10 is a lot more better than giving it a much more higher score. I can easily admire the characters or what they're feeling in this episode, but when you completely think about what people feel towards the development in this episode, then you probably don't understand what it feels if you can instantly feel the struggles from those characters. Yes, every human in the human race can't agree on one opinion, but at the same time, whenever they just look at most of the negatives, it's mostly difficult to understand where they're coming from. So, all that's left for this video is to reveal Duck Out, which is, well, Doug Moriarty going on a stakeout mission with Steven and Connie by your side. Usually, it's mostly those episodes where you expect the father character to deal with the struggle on being a good father, but the thing is, this is the same Doug that we've seen since his first appearance in the first season of this show. Even though that this is still a filler episode involving the problems of seasons 3 and onward filler episodes had, and maybe seasons 2, but I can't say that this episode is worthless. Since that this is the first time we get to see Doug Moriarty after the events of the second season, I can't say for a fact that this episode really mistreats his character, since that he's just trying to be a better father after his wife lifted off most of the rules of her relationship with Connie. When it comes to Doug himself, I really feel like that his motivations, regardless of him being the best of his abilities to try and mostly desperation, I really can't blame him regardless. If you really think about how he's just trying to be a better father after everything that happened in seasons 2, I'm pretty sure that you'll probably be in his footsteps if you ever have strict rules and you come to a term where you decide to lift off most of the rules in order to have more of a close relationship towards your son slash daughter. In the scene of Storm of the Womb, while Connie's mother picks her up from Steven's house, we don't get to see Richard whatsoever in these scenes, and it's mostly of how the writers or screen writers or storyboard writers or whatever are giving a little bit development involving Connie's mother, since that she really cares towards Connie a lot more after she completely lay off the restricted rules in the family. So, seeing Doug in this episode trying to be a good father by doing a stakeout mission, even though that he's not doing the best job at it, I really feel like that the fillerness in this episode is mostly done for how much that they just don't know what to do with Doug, unlike Connie's mother, who is mostly better developed since we see her interactions with Connie in season 2. If you really make me to believe that Doug is supposed to be all of what Connie's mother is, then you're expecting a little too much involving Doug in this show. Every time I think about this episode and the one time involving Doug and the kids, which makes me to believe that this is still a Beach City episode, even though that it doesn't involve any of the Beach City citizens, I can instantly tell that they just didn't know what to do with Doug in this show, even if there could have been potential if we get to see a few episodes centering around him and his wife on what they're feeling at the moment involving the daughter. But let me just tell you, even if I do have potential ideas for that, I don't think that they would easily work out for a show involving Steven and the fact that his friend Connie is willing to go on adventures with him. I'm just saying, I understand that people are really interested into the Crystal Gems, but when it comes to the Beach City citizens, even though that Doug and his wife isn't a Beach City citizen, I can't say that they really need more episodes for further development. They only need a few episodes and that's that. Granted, the filler episodes in the later seasons may be a bit irritating, but if you ask me, I really feel like that they're still harmless at the end of the day. It's just that most of the slots that these episodes are in order really feels a lot more difficult for people to find enjoyment when the attention is mostly into the major plots of the show. Granted, I can't say that for what's happening after Steven came back to Earth after going into outer space, and this is before he goes on trial. I really feel like that the episodes in season 4 are mostly harmless. But when it comes to season 5, jeez, it's probably gonna be a very long video once I get back to this story arc, believe me. Anyway, I better wrap this up, otherwise this video will be longer as it is. I'm giving this episode a 6 out of 10, and what I have in store for the final episodes of the Converse, believe me, it's gonna be much more longer than I'm really concerned of. And whenever I say that, it's mostly of how much that I need to give an understanding between the characters and the arcs that they're gonna be dealing with. And believe me, this anthology could end up fine, or turning out ugly, or somewhat both.